Okay, this is a absolutely bread and butter USMLE question, and it also happens to be one of my favorite topics. A 32-year-old female presents to the clinic with the complaint of excessive fatigue for the past few weeks. After returning home from the office, she feels too tired to climb up the stairs or even comb her hair or even chew food. She has occasionally experienced double vision. She denies having any fever, cough, weight loss, night sweats, or snoring. Past medical history is unremarkable. Physical examination reveals a blood pressure of 124 over 86, a heart rate of 85, a respiratory rate of 14, and a temperature of 37 degrees Celsius, and a body mass index of 22.6. On physical examination, the patient's right upper eyelid is slightly drooping compared to the left side. Her eye movements are normal. Flexion of the neck is mildly weak. Muscle strength is 5 out of 5 in all four limbs. When she is asked to alternate flexion and extension of her arm continuously for 5 minutes, power in the proximal upper limb becomes 4 out of 5. Muscle tone and deep tendon reflexes are normal. What is the most appropriate test? Normal. What is the answer choice A, a CT scan of the chest. Answer choice B, plasmapheresis. Answer choice C, presynaptic calcium channel antibodies. Answer choice D, single fiber electromyography. Or answer choice E, tensilon test. Now take a moment to come to your own answer before we go through it together. Okay, this is a great question. The topic here, you're going to be asked about it on USMLE in one way or another. Now, this is a neurology question, so that falls under internal medicine. And really here, we're dealing with a person who has some type of, hopefully you get the sense, neuromuscular junction or musculoskeletal, some kind of problem. So that falls under the category of neuro. Now, this is a two-step question. First thing we got to do is figure out what's the diagnosis. And then second thing we got to do is figure out the most appropriate test to diagnose the condition. And I really want you to pay attention to the fact that they use the word most appropriate test. When you glance at the answer choices, many ones are reasonable. I mean, there's not one glowing answer. This is actually a pretty tough question. But what they're asking for is the most appropriate test. So what's here really, you got to pay attention to the most appropriate, not just any old answer. So that's USMLE. It really narrows down to those small details. And of course, in this case, the stem is required because you have to be able to diagnose and then based on that diagnosis, figure out the best test to use. Now, let's do step one. First thing, let's determine the diagnosis. Now, the patient comes in with the chief complaint of fatigue. She has generalized muscle fatigue and exertion seems to make it worse. Now, fatigue has a really broad differential, and it includes, but not limited to, even things like endocrine disorders, such as hypothyroidism, viral infections, such as infectious mononucleosis, also called mono, or sleeping disorders, such as obstructive sleep mono, or sleeping fatigue, or even cardiovascular, or even respiratory pathologies, or even malignancy can make you tired. So fatigue has a really broad differential. So we got to look past that, look into the details of the question stem to come to the diagnosis. Now, very important in your thinking, think like this. She has no systemic complaints. We're told there's no fever, there's no weight loss, there's no night sweats. Her blood pressure is normal, her heart rate's normal, her respiratory rate's normal, there's no cough, there's no snoring. So really nothing systemically going on. But really what it sounds like is, you know, she wants to climb stairs, she wants to comb her hair, she wants to chew food, double vision. These all are muscle things, you know, like not being able to double vision. The muscles of mastication are tired, or comb your hair, that's proximal muscle weakness. Climbing stairs, that's proximal leg weakness. So really here we're thinking musculoskeletal problem, not systemic. Now, the key here is though, is that she actually has worse muscle weakness after exertion. Early on in the question stem, we're told that the fatigue is at the end of the day, so coming home after the office, and During examination, when they made her flex and extend her hand continuously for 5 minutes, strength in that limb went down from a perfect 5 out of 5 down to a 4 out of 5. So she got weak with repetitive use. Now, they also mentioned that in one of her eyes, she has drooping of her eyelid. This is also called ptosis. Now, ptosis really is unique. You don't see that very commonly. Ptosis is very likely seen, on USMLE at least, in a condition called myasthenia gravis. Now, you can support that diagnosis a few different ways. First thing they tell you is that the reflexes are normal, and in myasthenia, we expect it to be normal. Also, they give you a few specialized exams that are really more specific to myasthenia gravis. For example, repetitive muscle movement that's getting weak, that's extremely likely to be myasthenia gravis. And they also tell you a few more things. That flexion of the neck is mildly weak. Now, the neck is part of the axial structure. So if flexion of the neck is weak, that is some axial weakness. And what we actually do in neurology is use the weakness of neck flexion as an indicator of how much strength the diaphragm has. Because if you imagine, the diaphragm is also a muscle, so with myasthenia, patients can become too short of breath and may even require intubation. So they're actually giving you another big hint by telling you about neck flexion strength. Now, this is a classic case of myasthenia gravis. So now that we know the diagnosis, the patient has repetitive weakness upon repetitive muscle use. She has diplopia, some episodes of double vision. That's very common in patients with myasthenia because the extraocular muscles get fatigued. And she also has ptosis in one of her eyes, which is again very common in myasthenia. So here the diagnosis rather clearly is myasthenia gravis. Now, let's figure out what the answer is now based on how we can diagnose this patient most appropriately now that we know the diagnosis. Well, if you think about myasthenia itself, it's a disease that affects the neuromuscular junction. Now, looking at the image, you can see on the left a normal neuromuscular junction in which you have a myelin sheath, an axon. You actually have the acetylcholine being released from the neuron going into the neuromuscular junction and then going on to the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors, and then you'll have the muscle contract. Now look at the right side of that image, you have what's going on in the condition of myasthenia gravis, in which antibodies are actually directed at those same nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. Now imagine those antibodies are getting in the way in the receptors and the acetylcholine can't touch them. So if you can't get the acetylcholine touching the receptor, the muscle doesn't know to move. And then you actually have prevention of binding, and it gives you the weakness of myasthenia gravis. Now, why does repetitive movement make it worse? Because you're just building up more fatigue from not being able to move your muscle. Now, what ends up happening here, if you think about it electrically, you will have slow or a blocked electrical impulse between the neuron and the muscle at the neuromuscular junction. So really, the choice for testing myasthenia gravis is really to look at the interplay between acetylcholine at the neuromuscular junction. So we really have two choices here. We can do single fiber electromyography or EMG to measure the nerve conduction in the actual neuromuscular junction, or we can do what's called a tensilon test. Now, the tensilon test, tensilon is just a substance that is actually called edrofonium. Now, edrofonium is an acetylcholinesterase inhibitor, so it blocks the breakdown of acetylcholine. Now, calcium channel antibodies will also affect the acetylcholine neuromuscular junction function in a condition that is called Lambert-Eaton syndrome. So really, the tensilon test is not the test we use for myasthenia, it's what we use for Lambert-Eaton. So that then narrows down the answer to single fiber electromyography, and that's answer choice D as being the correct test. Now, just so you know, no one uses the tensilon test anymore. It causes bradycardia and has other side effects. We've gotten around that. Now, the reason why we use single fiber electromyography is because we are actually stimulating repetitive use to see if the diagnosis is correct. Now, if you ask a patient with myasthenia to repetitively move a limb, they're going to get tired. That's how the disease works. Well, what we do in Singer fiber electromyography is we take a needle, we actually put it in the thenar eminence of the hand and repetitively stim the muscle with very light electricity. And we will see graphs on a computer as to the actual movement of the electricity. And what we will see is as we are repetitively stimulating it, the actual amplitude of the electricity will go down because of all those antibodies blocking the way. And that's how we diagnose it electrographically. Now, when you look at these answer choices, now that you know the answer is myasthenia diagnosis and the best test is single fiber electromyography, let's look at the other answer choices to see how could you have eliminated the other ones to help increase your odds of picking the right answer. Now, obviously, answer choice D, this patient's coming in, fluctuating proximal muscle weakness that increases the fatigue with exertion and repetitive movements make it worse. This is definitely supposed to make you think myasthenia. It's an autoimmune condition. We talked about how it's antibodies against the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. Now, since it's an autoimmune condition, just remember, this disease is more common in young women than men, as with most autoimmune conditions. Now, with myasthenia, it commonly affects the muscles that move a lot. And that's going to be the eyes, the muscles of the face, bulbar muscles. Bulbar muscle is just a really fancy way of saying muscles that are controlled by cranial nerves in your head. That's all that means. And of course, proximal limb muscles. And that will give you the symptoms of ptosis, which is eyelid droop, diplopia, that's double vision from extraocular muscle fatigue, dysarthria, that's the muscles of swallowing that are controlled by the cranial nerves and talking. Dysphagia, also swallowing. Difficulty in chewing, muscles of mastication are going to be fatigued. And of course, proximal muscles, so climbing stairs and combing your hair. Now, since the disease is due to the antibodies against the acetylcholine receptor, you need to memorize that you are going to be having antibodies against the acetylcholine receptor. But USMLE is really, really, really clever. So it goes usually one step beyond that basic fact that's in most books. Now, in a small number of patients that have myasthenia, they actually have another type of muscle-specific tyrosine kinase antibody called MUSK, M-U-S-K. So in your head, I want you to memorize anti-acetylcholine receptor antibody or anti-MUSK as the two antibodies for myasthenia gravis, and given how USMLE has been performing lately, anti-MUSK is more likely to be tested sometimes because it's more rare and not as broadly taught, but you're hearing it here from me. Now, again, the repetitive nerve conduction study is how we diagnose it, and it's the best test for myasthenia. And say, for example, you get some serum from a patient and they're serum negative. There's no antibodies to the acetylcholine receptor or anti-MUSK, but that repetitive stim shows decrease. Well, wow, they still have myasthenia gravis. They just happen to have what's called seronegative myasthenia gravis. And that's why it's the most appropriate test for this patient, not just any old test. So that's, again, the key I was mentioning earlier. Answer the question being asked, what's the most appropriate best test? And it's the nerve conduction study, because even when you can't find antibodies in the serum, the nerve conduction study confirms a diagnosis. Now, let's look at the other answer choices. Answer choice A, CT scan of the chest. Now, this is relevant to myasthenia gravis. You do a CT of the chest in patients with myasthenia to look for a thymoma. And if you see it, you take it out, and usually the symptoms of the patient significantly improves. But this is a way to look for thymoma. It's not how you diagnose the condition. Now, look at answer choice B, plasmapheresis. Now, plasmapheresis is a machine that takes blood from your body, cleans out the antibodies, and puts the blood back. Now, this is an option we use for therapy. This is not diagnostic. This is a therapeutic modality. So what happens here is when patients are in what's called myasthenic crisis, meaning their myasthenia is so severe they can't safely swallow or breathe, we may have to intubate them and we'll usually give them something like plasmapheresis to try to clean out those bad antibodies to improve their symptoms. So answer choice C is presynaptic calcium channel antibodies. Now, these antibodies are specific for Lambert-Eaton syndrome, not myasthenia gravis. And if you were thinking, well, could this be Lambert-Eaton? Well, no, because repetitive stim of repetitive muscle use will actually improve muscle strength, not make it worse. And these patients actually have absent or depressed deep tendon reflexes, not normal, and they also have autonomic dysfunction. But very high yield to know for Lambert-Eaton, it's a paraneoplastic condition most highly associated with small cell lung carcinoma. And answer choice E, which is the Temsilon test or the edrophonium test. And again, that's an acetylcholine esterase enzyme inhibitor. But then and again, that's not the best test. It is the actual muscle test with the nerve conduction. And given all the side effects, no one uses a Temsilon test anymore. Okay, now let's review some high yield facts for this case. Now, myasthenia gravis. This is an autoimmune neuromuscular disease in which you actually have antibodies directed at the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. Now, it's not enough to just know it's acetylcholine receptors. Also memorize nicotinic, classically loved board question. Now, the onset of myasthenia gravis can be sudden or gradual. And the main symptom here, then you really need to memorize this, is increased muscle weakness on exertion or repeated use. So at the end of the day, the patient feels tired. After repetitive movements, you know, repetitive use, they feel tired. And the ocular region is actually the first place where patients are going to feel tired, because if you imagine, you're always moving your eyes nonstop. So your extraocular muscles become fatigued. Now, we diagnose myasthenia gravis most accurately with electromyography. And in this condition, of course, is more common in women than men, as is most autoimmune conditions. And really, treatment here starts with acetylcholine esterase inhibitors. That is, giving inhibitors that inhibit acetylcholine esterase to allow for more acetylcholine to be at the neuromuscular junction. Now, we also have more advanced therapies, such as immunosuppressants you can give people to decrease their immune system, given this is an autoimmune condition. We can also remove the thymus for people who have a thymoma, because it's been associated that thymus removal, and that's where we think the antibodies come from, the thymus, actually leads to an improved outcome, and in some patients, cured myasthenia. You can also do plasmapheresis, which is a technique in which you place a central line in a patient, remove blood, run it through a machine, take out the antibodies, and then give the blood back. And this can be used in more severe conditions. Now, electromyography is something that we said is a tool we use to diagnose myasthenia. Now, that's a diagnostic test, and we use it for neuromuscular diseases. Now, what we're actually doing with this test is detecting electrical potentials generated by muscle cells in response to us using a stimulator, giving an electrical stimulus to the muscle. Now, we can also use needle electrodes that we insert into the muscle, so it's a slightly invasive procedure, to check the actual activity of the muscle with our electrical stimulus.